Also pray and I'm led to speak to you briefly on the subject or the word that I've entitled the Great Commission, the Great Commission, the Great Commission. In other words, this is purely evangelistic teaching or sermon that I want to give. As this weekend, it was bubbling in my heart in regards to people coming to the Lord, the lost souls, and I asked myself, what is the purpose of the church? In fact, that became a burden on my heart. And I said, you know what? Many a times we will wait and wait until it's evangelism week, and then we'll go and speak about soul winning and all that. But this morning, I want us to look into the scriptures and see what is our responsibility and what we can also do. Amen. So let's take a word of prayer. Father, we want to bless you and thank you for each and everyone. We thank you for this day given to us, for this is the day you have made. We will rejoice and be glad in it. As we hear your word, we pray, O God, for clarity of speech. I pray for your anointing over your word. I pray for the hearts of the people, Lord, that there will be a heart that will receive your word, that their lives may also be affected by your word. Thank you, Lord, in Jesus' name. Amen.
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 Okay. I think everybody is muted except me. Okay, I got it. Yes. If you hear my voice, then somebody wave your hand. Let me see. That. Okay, good. It's good. Good. That way I don't waste my, I don't waste everything. Okay. Yes, talking about the Great Commission, the Bible says something in the book of Psalms, Psalm 126, that I really love so much. Psalm 126, verse number 6. It says, those who go out, who go out weeping, carrying seed to sow, will return with songs of joy. Carrying seed to sow will return with songs of joy, carrying sheaves with them. Amen. Now, God is admonishing all of us to go and preach the gospel to the world. This world that we see, a day will come that it will no more be in existence as it is, And a day will come that all men will be judged as prescribed by the Lord, as the Lord has already said in his word, that one day he's going to judge the world. And for that reason, he gave us Jesus so that those that will believe and accept him will not go into destruction. And now by his grace, you and I have been saved. And the question is, do we leave others to remain in the destruction, or do we help them by giving them the word of God, which is free of charge? Amen. So in Mark 28, verse 18 to 20, that one, in fact, I will need somebody to help me do the readings. It will be a few more readings here and there. And I'll try to save most of the readings so that we can speed up. So if somebody can read Matthew 28, 18 to 20, it was one of our team. Verses. Anybody looking can read for us. Matthew 28.
28, verses 18. Okay, I'm reading from the New King James Version. It says, and Jesus
that will be
came.
Reading has to unmute himself so or herself so that I can read. Yes, Mami Dakon. Yes.
Okay. Matthew 28, verses 18. I'm reading from the New King James Version. It says, and Jesus came and spoke to them, saying, all authority has been given to me in heaven and on earth. Go therefore, 19, go therefore and make disciples of all nations,
is anybody baptizing reading? Them. Hey, Mantio, yes. So if you are done, then yes. You wave your hand.
Please,
why, is something
please
wrong?
Can you hear me?
Yes, we can hear you.
Okay. So the 19 says, go therefore and make disciples.
Okay. All right.
The 19 says, go therefore and make disciples of all.
I think there's something wrong with my volume. Okay.
With all.
Okay.
You could go ahead and read.
Okay. Go therefore and make disciples of all the nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit.
There's something wrong with my volume, so.
20 says, teaching them to
observe. Probably switch to this little thing here with me. Otherwise, we cannot connect well.
Yes.
Please forgive me.
Yes. Mm-hmm. So we'll just hold on with this.
Okay. Jesus instructed his disciples to evangelize the whole world and go and teach all nations. Amen. As we just saw in Matthew 28, verse 18 through 20. He said, Jesus came and spoke to them saying, all authority has been given to me, my God, in heaven and on earth. Go, therefore, and make disciples of all the nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all things that I have commanded you. And lo, I am with you always, even to the end of the age. Amen.
Amen.
So Christ has given instructions to the disciples, and the same instructions has been passed on to us to do. You see, as a church, we sometimes forget our primary purpose on earth. We sometimes forget about our mission, which is to go and preach the gospel or share the good news with others. Sometimes we forget. We forget. And rather we give attention to other things, which are also important, but this is the primary purpose is to go preach the gospel. But oftentimes other things take precedent, you know, take the priority, first priority, which shouldn't be. We give attention to raising money here, we give attention to building projects, we give attention to, which is good, again, I said, it's all good, but we give attention to this and meetings upon meetings, seminars upon seminars, and all that. And most often, we end up not doing what God is expecting us to do first, which is to preach the gospel, win souls. I pray in the name of Jesus that we will all make conscious effort to win souls one by one. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Which is the most important thing that we are supposed to do as a church. Amen. So
Amen.
Giving our attention to other things, because of that, only few people will go. So for this reason, it is just little church growth that we see, little church growth. And most churches' growth results from just moving from like somebody said, trading in sheep. You know, this one will move from here, and then he moved from Ghana, and then he came here, and then he joined the church. We all did, right? And then somebody will move from Norcross or in New York or somewhere and come. I'm a member of Church of Pentecost in Brooklyn, and I moved down here. And you go like, yay, we get another person. It's the same sheep, man. We haven't won anyone new. And there are a lot of people around us who are heading towards fire. Imagine you see your neighbor's house, fire catching that house, and it had just started, maybe from the backyard or the side of the building, and you know that you can do something about it. Maybe you have just started from the roof. At least you go and knock the door, and I can imagine you use all your strength to bang on the door and shout and scream. If you can call, scream and say, hey guys, there is fire, there is fire, there is fire. You will not stand aloof and just look at them and the fire starting from the back of the house or on the sidings or on the roof, be burning and burning and burning and say, oh, it's coming. Oh, it's coming, it's coming. No, you will never do that. You bang on the door and say that, guys, come out, because there is a destruction coming into your home. You guys are going to burn. In fact, you do it and do with joy. Like, you see, the book of Psalms that we read, he said, those that carry, you know, seed and go and sow and come back, they come back with joy, with sheaves, bearing sheaves, with joy. So as we do this, there is joy that bubbles in our hearts. I quite remember when I first became born again, I joined the evangelism team. And most of you too, I believe. As we go out as a new baby, every time we preach the gospel to somebody, and the leader will say, when we go to this home, you will share the word. And I share the word with them as a baby Christian and lead them to Christ. Oh my God, come see joy in me. It's like the fire is rekindled, and I feel like we got to go more. And I couldn't wait till the next Sunday that the team leader will call us. It was so joyful to see people giving their lives to Christ. Beloved, every time you share the gospel of Jesus Christ to people, oh my God, joy begin to bubble in your heart. I pray this spirit will come upon all of us, the young, the old, everyone. Everyone, regardless of your age, so long as you can speak, there is breath in you, you can share the gospel so that others will come to the saving knowledge of Jesus Christ. Amen. This is what God has given to us that we are supposed to do. So we shouldn't depend on people, you know, moving from this assembly to that assembly only. No, that is not real evangelism. It's stepping out, sharing the gospel with others. Amen. So we must get back to the plan of God as a church that says that we got to go and preach the good news unto others. Amen. Amen. The first thing that we are to do, if we are going to do that, is to make sure that we follow what God has already instructed us, what Jesus gave to these people to do. Because why? It is easier to always show or demonstrate in the church other things. It's easier for me to do other things. It is easier for you to do other things than to go and preach on the street or share the gospel with others, which is true. Huh? It is not easy for you to go. That is why we are admonishing you so that you and I will make conscious effort to win souls every time we step out. There is a man called Smith Wigglesworth. Smith Wigglesworth, every time that when he became born again, the fire of God was burning. He was a man, I mean, so anointed. Wigglesworth was so anointed, and not just anointed, but the spirit of evangelism was so strong on him that every time he would step out, he would say, Lord, give me a soul. Give me a soul. Every time you say, give me a soul. And I quite remember in the 80s, the first time I read his book, I said, wait a minute. If this is what he did, and every time he would say, give me a soul, Wigglesworth would definitely find a soul. And according to the testimony that I read, one time it was very late, he was in home. I said, Lord, I went to work the whole day. I didn't get a soul. No, I can't sleep. Give me a soul. And Wigglesworth decided to go and buy milk in the night. And as soon as he stepped out, the store owner was about to close. And he waved him, he said, he begged him to let him in. And then he entered. As soon as he entered, a man also followed him that wanted to buy something there. Rugerford turned everything onto the new guy who had just entered and then shared the gospel. He would just share the gospel with you. The man accepted Christ and then prayed with him. Then he came back fulfilled, knowing very well that he has fulfilled the commitment, I mean, his purpose for that particular day. Hallelujah. And back to the story. So in the 80s, I said, Lord, I said, wait a minute. If you were able to give the unction for Wigglesworth to do this, I need this too. If you are the same God of Smith Wigglesworth. And I will never forget, at that time I was in Europe. Every time before I step out, I say, Lord, give me a soul. Give me a soul. And every day I got opportunity to share the gospel with somebody. Sometimes I would lead people to accept Christ right in the bus, right in the train, right at the train station, everywhere, one by one, not publicly with a microphone. No, 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 no. In my own way, the way God has designed for me to do it, one by one. And as I kept doing that, the Spirit of God also connected people to my path. Right people that need the gospel, right place, right word for them, you know, and God gave me the courage, the boldness to do it one by one. And one night I was coming from work, it was about 11:30, and I took the last train. This is my testimony. I took the last train and I said, Lord, today I did not get a soul. Today I did not get a soul. And as I was going, it was just one stop to my station where I would get off. And the train was going to close. As soon as the conductor was closing the train, I saw that a man jumped into the train. You know, those of you who have been in trains, you know, trying to join a train, how it goes, you know. He jumped like that. Then boom, the man sat down and go like, I look at him, it was a Ghanaian, I said, man. And then the Lord said, that is your soul. Preach to him. So it's only me and him to the next station. Come see, I dump all the gospel on this man. He accepted the Lord in the train. And as I got off the train at the next station and I was leaving, oh my God, that day, look as if I've received millions of dollars. I pray in the name of Jesus that this spirit will come upon all of us. Me too, I'll go back for this kind of spirit, this kind of attitude for the Lord. Amen.
Amen.
It is the heartbeat of God that people will be saved. In the book of Jude, he said, there are some who are perishing, who are going into the fire. He says, snatch them from fire. He says, snatch them. Snatch them. If you see your son getting burned and you know that you can do something about it, you will snatch him or her. Hallelujah. Men are going to hell. And I always say that there are some people that will see you in heaven and say, Dave, thank you very much. Had it not been you. Had it not been you. Had it not been you sharing the gospel with me. Elder, thank you very much. My sister, thank you very much. So, beloved, it behooves on us to carry the gospel. It's free and give it to others one by one. Youngsters among the youth, talk to your friends. We chat with them all night, you know, encourage them one by one. And there was one time that this youth small group, they were praying. And I said, what are you going to say? We have formed a group. It said the name is S-O-G. I said, what is that? He said, Sons of God. I said, what do you guys do? He said, we are trying to win souls one by one. I said, good. 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 If you use your phone for good things, that is good. If you're going to use the phone beside games and studying and all that, and also win others for Christ, that is good. Amen. That is good. So God is admonishing all of us to go and preach the gospel unto others. Amen. I said earlier that it's not easy sometimes. It is easy for everybody in the church to be on the church board, to be an officer, to be a movement leader. It's easy, right? It's easy for you to, it's even easy for me to go and teach in Sunday school and all that. But when it comes to go and preach the gospel, save others, we tend to forget because the devil knows that people will come to Christ. And so sometimes he will let us forget. Sometimes he will make us feel apathy. We don't feel like it. The bottom line is, why are we not going? Truthfully speaking, it's like we don't care. Amen. It may be the hard truth, though. So hard. Yes. Sometimes, if we see that the kids are in the church and nobody is taking care of them, the youth, nobody is taking care of them, this one is neglected. It's easy for us to step in, which is a great idea. But when it comes to going out to share the gospel, that is tough. Let's say this Saturday, you say, oh, we are all going for evangelism. Let's meet. You will see how many people will come. Maybe just after this message, our minds will change. Amen. Our minds will change. So I'm just trying to say that going out there is, as compared to doing the work in right in the house, the four walls, is easier than going out there. But our primary purpose, our mission, our call, the very reason why God has called us to go and share it with our, he said, testify, go and tell what the Lord has done for you. The woman at the well, he ran. She ran to the city and said, come see a man that I have seen. He have told me everything, every secret. He is the Messiah. You see, this woman, she went and shared what God has done for her. What has the Lord done for you? Hallelujah. It's easy to give money. It's easy for me to, I want to challenge you, but sometimes my pocket, you know, is ended. Amen. I love to give offering. When I give, I feel like, yes, I've done the work of God. But God is telling me today that it's good also to win soul. You see, it's easier for me to say that I'm giving so that somebody will go and preach. Honestly speaking, it's easier. If I have $1,000, I will give it. Sometimes fellow ministers in the missions field will call me and say, oh, pastor, you know, can you tell the congregation we want to do this, we want to do that. When I know that if I bring it to the congregation and collecting money will be difficult and I have it, I will just send it myself if I have it and go and support them. You see, it's easy for me to do that. Amen. But the next day, sometimes I forget that those souls, there are some of them around me. Some of my neighbors are not even born again. We meet them all the time. And sometimes we will spend time and chat with them and chat with them and chat with them, and then we forget. Amen. Let's make conscious effort. I remember I give you this testimony. I remember working, we were going for our building committee meeting. I think I was there first and this time. And I was speaking to one of the contractors. I was looking at them, the Lord told me, do you think this man knows the Lord? Share the word of God with him. I started sharing the word. And right outside, tears started flowing. And I said, you want to accept the Lord? He said, yes. And then he was accepting the Lord. I think that Dodu, and Dr. Dodu came and he saw it. As he was coming, I said, let me finish my prayer quickly before it's interrupted. And he saw it. And then after that, I said, how do you feel? He said, I feel good. I said, do you go to church? I said, yes, I'm looking for a church to go. I want him to go to a church that he will be accepted and everything so that he will feel comfortable, culturally, and everything. Amen. And he said, yes, I will do that. Beloved, these people are just around us. Amen. Just around us. Instead of sitting in the church and we pick and we grumble about this, about that. This one was supposed to do this. I was supposed to do that. This one was supposed to do that. This time term is over and all that. Please, it's time for us to move on. Let's make effort, conscious effort, so that we will go and save lives. Save lives. Like Dr. Dodu is saying, we can't wait to go back to church so that we can really, really enjoy everything, do real flock count and all that, which is something that we are all expecting. Amen. It's easy for us to do other things. It's easy to be, you know, to be part of a faction that will get into action and all that. But it's not easy to go. Amen. And every time that I remember a church begins to go, that church also begins to grow. Amen. Every time we begin to step out and go and evangelize, we begin to go and share the gospel, that church also begin to grow as well. You see that one by one, people will be coming into that church. Amen. So God's, the next thing I want to talk about is we have to be part of God's plan, which is weeping. As we go, we will be weeping. He said, he that go forth and sow and weeping. It's not easy, weeping. Most of us do not go because it's not easy. And it's sometimes, again, like I said, we do not care. And genuine concern for souls is needed. At our workplaces, share the gospel. There are so many ways. You see, God will give you what to say. When you go, he said, do not wonder what you're going to say. The Holy Spirit will give you what to say. You can start with a little conversation. Just the attire that the person is wearing. That's pretty jacket. Oh, thank you. With a smile. Well, he's already open now for you to start a conversation. You know, things. I like your haircut. I like your hairdo. Oh, thank you. He's open up to you already. Amen. Some of you are at customer service, one-on-one. You engage them in conversations and you slip the gospel into it. Give him the word. Give him the word. I shared my uncle's, you know, younger uncle, his testimony. It was so funny. He shared it with me. He said that he never liked to go to church, want to hear anything. And every time the wife would talk about John 3:16 and all that. And one day, as he was sleeping, I don't know if I've shared this gospel with this testimony. If you have shared it, wave your hand. I didn't see your hand. That means you have not heard. He said one day she got drunk and he went to bed and he gets such a severe headache. He woke up, he felt like dying. And then the only thing, this voice was telling this man, John 3:16, in the middle of the night, the wife is sleeping. They were both sleeping on the bed. And then he woke up and then he said, what is this 3:16 thing? And then he said, Adjoa. He said, why? I'm sleeping. He said, well, John 3:16. He said, what is John? He said, where is it in the Bible? John 3:16. And the woman, you know, reluctantly woke up and took a Bible for him, turned light on, and then gave it, opened it, and then gave it to him, and then went to sleep. And then this man read it, and the Lord spoke to his heart. Amen. The Lord spoke to his heart. Because he's heard the word before, he rejected it. But along the line, because the word was still hidden in the heart, at that point in time, the Lord woke him up and said, this is the time. Let's sow the word. And as we sow it, it will never go back to the Lord void without accomplishing the purpose for which it was sent. Amen. So we need to have real concern for the souls. Amen. Paul's heart was broken for souls. When you read Romans chapter 9, verse 1 to 3, his heart was broken for souls. He wanted people to receive the word of God like never before. Apostle Paul, he didn't understand why his fellow Jewish people would not come to this to Christ, and he was so agonized. He wanted them to be saved. Everywhere Paul found himself, even to the point that ship was going to sink, he said, no, I haven't finished my work. None of us is going to die here. Praise the Lord. The man had a burden. I pray that we too, we will have the same burden. Romans chapter 9, verse 1 to 3, there's something also that he said, I speak the truth in Christ. I'm not lying. My conscience confirms it through the Holy Spirit. I have great sorrow. Listen to him. I have great sorrow and unceasing anguish in my heart. Do we have unceasing anguish? Do we have great sorrow in our heart? For I could wish that I myself were cursed and cut off from Christ for the sake of my people, my fellow Jews, for those of my own race. What is Paul trying to say? Paul is saying that I wish that I myself, even I'm dead, so that these people, this thing that I'm preaching, they don't get it. That Christ is the way. He is the savior. He is the one that will save them. He is their everything. They don't get it. Lord, I wish I myself am dead so that they will be saved. That they will say that, oh, all this that this guy was saying, struggling for us to understand, we didn't understand until he's dead now. He said, I wish I'm dead just for them because you are the truth. And they are not getting, that is a burden. I pray in the name of Jesus that you have a burden. May the Lord lay that burden on our heart. Amen. He said, the people of Israel, the people of Israel. Paul had a burden. Amen. You see, these are tears of the heart. Tears of the heart. If you have a burden, let us seek first his kingdom and in this righteousness. Let us preach the gospel to others. Hallelujah. As we do that, oh, hallelujah. As we do that, God will definitely make sure that those who are lost are also saved. Seeing the lost as God also sees them is very, very critical. Seeing as God sees them, as we see them, he's lost. Oh, he's lost. Today, believers, we don't even intercede for them anymore. We don't even intercede for them anymore. I pray that at least we will intercede for them. Then the next part that we are supposed to do join by joining God's plan is do the sowing. Bearing precious seed. The word of God is the seed. Amen. When you read Luke chapter 8, he talks about it. He said, So I went to sow. The parable of the sower, Matthew 13, verse 3 to 23, is so long, so we cannot read it. But write it down, please. This scripture there, I want you to write it down. Matthew 13, verse 3 to 23. Amen. He said, a sower went to sow. Some of the seed fell on the wayside. Some also fell on the stony ground. Some also fell on thorns. And some also fell on good soil. I don't know what kind of seed he had. Maybe it was like, what is it, rice? Man, I'm not a good farmer. Maybe rice, I understand they throw it like that or something. And so probably it's one of those little seeds that you don't necessarily have to consciously dig a ground and put it in. Nobody will just go on the ground and on the stone and put it there. He said, some of them fell. It fell. That means he threw it, maybe. And some went on the rocks, some also went on the thorns, some also fell on good grounds. Amen. The one that fell on the rocks, we all know that there were some soil there, but because it will kind of like, you know, germinate, but it won't get any deep root because eventually it's going to hit the rock and it will go nowhere. And that the one in the thorns, you know, the thorns will, you know, will prick it and fight it so that it won't even work anymore. And then some also fell on good ground. Some also fell on wayside. No, you know, I don't think he consciously said, I'm going to put it on. Even if he put it on the wayside, he says bears came to eat it. Listen, as we sow the gospel sparingly everywhere, some will fall on good grounds. Some will come to the saving knowledge of Jesus Christ. There are some that will give their lives to Christ. Amen. People are perishing. People are dying. People are dying. No amount of money will save them in heaven. In heaven, only the gospel. Hallelujah. So, beloved, the one that fell on good soil, as we all know, germinated and then became something profitable. Amen. Those were the sheaves that they came back, that, you know, reaping. So, will this also, as we are sharing this with you, we want to make sure that we are doing what God is has instructed us to do. We are preaching the gospel to others, your friends, your co-workers, people around you. Amen. So that we will all come to the saving knowledge of Jesus Christ, which is very, very, very important. Amen. Very, very, very important. So what do we do? We sow. We are talking about sowing. We sow by speaking to others about Christ. That is the sowing. Just sharing the gospel, as I demonstrated by, you know, looking for clues, looking for opportunities to share. You see, every time you have made a conscious effort that today I'm going to preach to somebody, Lord, give me a soul, I guarantee you, Christ will bring somebody. The Holy Spirit will bring somebody to your path. It could be the cashier who will engage you. Instead of him giving you a gospel, you can also, you know, it can turn the other way around. Amen. So let's make this effort to do it. We do the sowing by consistently living a life that will be pleasing unto the Lord. It's also part of sowing, our lifestyle. Our lifestyle. Somebody look at you and say, I want to be like you, man. My sister, I feel like being like you. You got something that is so unique, I don't even know what it is. And then you will tell her or him what it is. People will admire you for your lifestyle, the kind of lifestyle that you live, the consistent Christian lifestyle that you live. That is part of the sowing. Amen. By using the gospel tracts and other literatures, as you do that, you pass it around. A person will read and say, this Jesus thing that they've been talking about. Hallelujah. You may also find other ways to share the gospel with them in your own way as you are led by the Spirit of God. Amen. And the last plan that I want to talk about briefly, and then I will bring my teaching to an end, is the fact that God's plan is that we are to reap. Remember what Jesus said? He said, look at the field. It's so ripe that we need people to be on the field and reap. He says those people, as I read in some 126 verse 6, he says they come back with joy, reaping, bearing the sheaves. Amen. Reaping. The field is so wide, ripping, and we need to go and share it. We'll come back. After somebody has sown, we can reap. So it's sowing and then what? Reaping. Sowing and reaping. We must make effort to reap. In other words, win people to Christ. The sowing is the word. It's the word that you are giving. Amen. Reaping is winning them for Christ. Don't leave souls winning to others only. You also, me also, are to be involved. Amen. We are also to get into the blessing that God has, you know, given to others for them to receive crowns and all that. We too, we are to preach the gospel and be part of God's blessing that he has given to all of us to go for. Amen, and receive. We must make efforts to make sure that we share the gospel, as I've already said, so that others will come. As we do this, our churches will be full when we are open. Even if we are not open on the line, others may join us. So let us return to the basic message of Jesus Christ, that we should go and preach the gospel unto others. Praise the Lord. That is the basic message. Going back to winning souls, that is what God is expecting all of us to do. And that soul winning brings rejoicing, even not only in the future, but also now. We will be rejoicing now for the fact that we have been able to win somebody for Christ, and also in the future, because there will be reward for us. And it is so joyous to see somebody come to Christ. So as we get involved, our churches will be filled, lives will be saved. We will also be rejoicing. We will be rejoicing now on this planet Earth, and also in the future when we get to heaven. May the Lord encourage us so that we will all make effort. We will all make conscious effort so that we win souls one by one unto Christ Jesus. For that is our basic God-given duty. Amen.
Amen.
And what a wonderful